Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I am Zdeněk Hanzálek, and thank you for watching this session of the scheduling seminar. Christoph Dürr will speak today about some scheduling problems with uncertainty, and let me say a few words about his past. So he graduated as a state-certified computer scientist in 1990, at Akademie für Datenverarbeitung, sorry for that, in Böblingen. And then he graduated in University of Paris Sud in quantum serial automata. Then he was on postdoc at Berkeley in Jerusalem. And finally, he got position in Paris. So he's interested in quantum computing, discrete tomography, algorithmic game theory, and now he mostly works in scheduling and online computing. He will leave soon to University of Chile for 1 year. And that's briefly about him. So Christoph, welcome. It's great to have you here. And please tell us what you know about scheduling.
Yes, okay. Okay, thank you a lot to invite me in this seminar. Hello, hello Asia, hello America, hello Europe, hello the rest of the world. So let me start with some advertising, okay, very quickly. So if you like competitive programming or if you teach algorithms in Python, we wrote a book that you might be interested in. You can read it in French, in Chinese, or in English. Yeah. Okay, but now let's start with the talk. So scheduling with uncertainty has been studied a lot, but the explorable part is something new. And there are three models that have been studied in the past, very recent past, and I will give an overview of the three. So let's start with a very simple scheduling problem. By the way, did you notice that most of the scheduling papers, they start, here is the most important scheduling problem, and then some description of a problem. So I think this is, I don't know if this is the most important, but this is a very elementary problem. So you have a single machine, and you have n jobs. And every job j has a processing time and a priority weight. And so if you schedule them, you put them in some order, let's say here in this example, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then every job will have a completion time. And yeah, the width of the rectangle is the processing time. And this defines the completion time. And you want to minimize the weighted sum of the completion time. So this is a very standard problem. The idea is that you don't want the jobs to wait for too long, but there is some priority. They're not all the same importance. For example, if you want to print your boarding pass, you don't want to wait for the big PhD thesis to print out that your student sent to print a job. Okay, so here, I mean, for this problem, it's well understood since 60 years or more that the optimum order is the one that orders the job with non-increasing or let's say decreasing, for example, Smith ratio. So you divide for every job the weight over the processing time, gives a sort of density that they represent here by the shade of the gray. And you want to put more dense, more with higher ratio jobs at the beginning. Okay, so this is something that is well understood. Okay, so if a client comes to you and tells you, oh, I want to solve this problem, then you can tell him, oh, I know how to solve your problem. Just give me the processing time and the weights. And the client, of course, he's the one that has the tie. He says, well, we don't have this information right now. So in fact, I haven't done many industrial projects, but what I do know is that it's actually very hard to get the data. This is a big part of industrial project. So this creates the need to study a model where you ask for the data, and you know, the more data you ask or the more precise you know your data, the better quality you can produce. So this whole area is about finding a balance of these two things. And yeah, let's look at the first model that I want to present to you. So there are several reasons. I mean, in general, let's step a little bit back. There are some research papers that solve very long-standing open problem that are very impressive. And then there are other papers that open an area and they get less exposure, but I think they are also very important. So this paper here, I think it didn't get enough exposure, and that's why I want to talk to you about it. It's by Levi, Magnanti and Shaposhnik. And when Ratzef Levi presented his work in a Dachstuhl seminar, this was the kind of talk where you said, okay, let's drop everything I'm doing right now and move in that direction. That was very inspiring. So he presented the problem like this. Suppose you want to serve patients in an emergency department, and you don't know how long it takes for each patient to be served and how urgent it is, but you can make some very quick diagnostic to get more information. Okay, but now let's look at the formal problem, and I change the notation for the talk. So in the paper, it's quite different. So you have again a single machine and jobs. At each job has a processing time, Pj, and a priority weight, Wj. And these times actually are drawn randomly from a joint distribution. So suppose that, okay, so suppose that you have some upper bound on the weight, and you have also an upper bound on the processing time, then these define a box. Let's say you have a probability mass of one distributed on the box. Then you draw a point from that box that gives you the processing time and the weight of a specific job. And every job is drawn independently from this same distribution. And you know the distribution. So initially you don't know the actual job characteristics, only the distribution. But you can do a test as an algorithm that computes a schedule along the way. You can do a test, pick a job, and this test will reveal processing time and the weight. And the test will take a time. Okay. An example, we want an example. Okay, slow down, everyone calm down. I give you an example, okay. So let's look at this example here. We have four jobs. Suppose you start with the test of the job one, takes time one. And then you see, oh, it's a very dense job. It has high Smith ratio. Maybe you decide to execute it right away. And then you decide to test the job two. And let's say it has a very small ratio. Then you decide to postpone its execution to the end. And then maybe you execute the job three and four without having tested them. So you don't need to test everything. So now, in such a schedule, the weighted sum of completion time is a random variable, and you want to minimize the expected value of it. That's a very clean problem. And what you need to decide is, what job to test and when to execute jobs. Of course, if you test everything, then you have full information, but you start all the schedule very late because of all the tests. And if you don't test, then you might not put them in a good order because initially there's no way for you to distinguish the jobs. Okay. So remember, for the original work, the Smith ratio was important. So it's also the case here. Suppose we put along a line, an axis here, the jobs according to the Smith ratio. So the jobs that you already have been tested, I presented them by a cross, a blue cross, and they're along this axis here, from low to high Smith ratio. And then there are two ratios that are important. One is called Rohexe and the other one is called Rohtest. So Rohexe is a sort of expected Smith ratio. It's not really, so pay attention, it's not really the ratio of the weight W over the processing time. It's in fact the expected weight over the expected processing time. So this is a bit different, but in fact, the expected processing time has some importance in the schedule. This is by how much it will, if you execute a job, by how much it will delay the tests. And so this is why it's distinguished like this. And then there's another ratio that is important. It's called the Rohtest test. And it's, and I explain it in the following way. Suppose that you execute, you test a job, J, and you decide, okay, now you execute it right after the test. That's actually a good thing because when you test a job, why do you test a job? Because you want to find out jobs that have very high ratio. So then it was benefit. So if you execute it right away, then the time of the test, somehow it adds to the execution time and the total time of the job plus, I mean, the test plus the execution takes this time, 1 plus pj. Sort of if you divide the weight of the job over this combined length, then you obtain some ratio. And the expected ratio of this is called the Rohtest. So the idea is that this is sort of threshold to test jobs. And before you decide to test jobs or to execute jobs, you compare with these ratios in the following way. Okay, so at any moment in time, you have these n jobs. Among those that haven't been executed yet, some you have tested them and you know the ratio in blue cross, and some jobs you don't know, they're untested. These are the green dots, round dots. And I draw them here. So this is a sort of ratio that you expect, not exactly that, but sort of ratio that you expect if you execute them without testing. Okay, so the following is known. So these two ratios, rho exe and rho test, they divide this axis into three parts: low ratio jobs, high, medium ratio jobs, and high ratio jobs. And these authors, they show that it's dominant to schedule high ratio jobs right away. It's always best to schedule them right away. And if you schedule them, of course, you schedule them from the highest ratio to the lowest ratio job. And then if you executed them, then you have to decide whether you want to test a job, one of these green jobs here, or whether you want to execute the job. And this must be a job that is a medium ratio job that has, and of course you will execute that one with the highest ratio among those. But if they're only low ratio jobs, then if you want to test it, you just test the job. Okay, so this dominance gives some structure to an algorithm. In fact, you can do the following. You compare these two ratios. In fact, they don't have to be in this order, right? So if the ratio rho test is smaller than rho exe, then it's optimal to schedule all the jobs without testing. And you will execute them in this order of decreasing Smith ratio from highest to lowest. Then you execute all those untested, and then you execute from all the low ratio jobs. In fact, you will execute all the jobs untested. Yeah, you don't have any jobs in that setting, in the diagram in that case. But if these ratios are ordered like in this diagram, but then there is some non-empty interval here, then it's dominant to schedule the jobs in two phases. At every moment, you execute all high ratio jobs. And then in the phase one, you will test some job. And if it turns out to be high ratio, you execute it right away. And otherwise it will insert somewhere among those tested jobs. And in the second phase, you will just execute all pending jobs in order of the decreasing Smith ratio. So given this dominant structure, the algorithm is now quite easy. You don't have to decide much. You just have to decide when to switch to the phase two. When do you want to stop testing? Okay. And how do you decide that? So there is a bit naive way to describe the best decision. You can do dynamic programming, and the state of an algorithm, so the position at any moment during the execution, what parameters are important, the number of untested jobs, total weight of low ratio jobs, total weight of medium ratio jobs, total processing time of medium ratio jobs, and the expected cost generated by a testing job. So with all these parameters, the Cartesian product defines the space of the dynamic program, and you could compute optimally, you could compute the optimum solution. But this is not very efficient, but you can use this standard trick of rounding weights and processing times to according to an exponential scale. And then this gives you a fully polynomial approximation scheme. Okay. So this is what people have done on this problem. And there is more result. There are more results in that paper, but this is the one that I wanted to present you. All right. So now let's go back to our customer. So we can tell him, oh, okay, now I know how to solve your problem. Just give me the distribution on processing time and weights. But it could be that the customer tells you in that case, well, I don't even have this information. I don't even know the distribution. Okay, so if the distribution is not known, then you have to move to an adversarial model. And so this leads to the model number two. The model number two, we motivate like this. Suppose you want to send files over a network connection, and it takes some time. And these files have different length. But you could try to compress those files first, right? But compressing, you don't know whether you will get a gain or not. You might compress a file that was already compressed, then you spend time for nothing. It's not shorter, but it might actually help you. So with Thomas Erlebach, Nicole Megow, and Julia Meißner, we studied a problem in a paper called Adversarial Model for Scheduling with Testing. And it's the following model. So it's again a single machine and jobs. And what are the processing time of the jobs? So a job J, if it's not tested, it will execute at a time UJ. And you know this time UJ. And if you test it, then it will reveal a time PJ, and it will take this time PJ. So how does a test work? You choose a job, then you test it. This takes time one on the schedule. Like here, you test the job number one, takes time one. And then it will reveal the processing time that is anything between U0 and UJ. So UJ is a sort of upper bound. If you don't test it, it will always take this upper bound to execute. Okay, then maybe you decide this is short. Let's execute it right away. Then you test the job number two. Or this long, maybe you decide scheduled at the end, and then maybe you decide to schedule 3 and 4 untested. So there are no weights in this model. The cost is just the sum of completion times. So that's the model. This was the example. But what is the objective, or how do we measure quality of an algorithm? Let's look at an example with a single job. There's just one job. So if you don't test it, then it will take time U1. But in the worst case, in fact, PJ, P1 was just 0. And yeah. Okay, you executed like this. But if you test it, then maybe in the worst case for this objective, it will reveal that the processing time is still U1. Okay. So if you compare these two scenarios, then the worst of them is to test it. So if you just want to minimize the sum of completion times, then you would never dare to test the job. But that's not the right way to look at the problem. In fact, what we think we should do, we should divide this objective value, sum of pj's, by the optimum. And this is then called a competitive ratio. So competitive ratio would be, for a specific algorithm, the objective value produced by the algorithm on an instance I divided by the optimum on I. And an instance is this vector of persisting times and upper bounds. And the optimum is very easy because the optimum is someone that knows actually whether it was interesting to test a job or not. It will test a job if and only if the testing time plus this revealed processing time pj is less than uj. Then it's interesting to test the job. And it will schedule the jobs in order of increasing the minimum of these two sides of the inequality. Okay, this is how you compare it to opt. This is what opt is about. And so you compare with an optimum that actually knows whether it was interesting to test the job or not. And this competitive ratio somehow measures the price of this hidden information. So now we would like to find an algorithm that has smallest possible competitive ratio, and this is our measure. So now I know that you ask, why do we call this competitive ratio? There's nothing online in that problem, right? But it's still a problem with hidden information. So we just borrow all the terminology and language from the area of online algorithms, even though it's not online. I mean, all the jobs are there from the beginning, okay? So let's do a warm up with a single job. Okay, just one job. And okay, two possibilities for an algorithm. You schedule the job untested. Okay, it takes your time, U1. And in the worst case, you should have tested it. Oh no, PJ was just zero. And the optimum just pays the time of the test plus zero. Okay, and the ratio here is U1 over 1 plus pj, which is 0, which is just U1. Okay, second scenario, the algorithm tests the job. Okay, tests the job, and in the worst case, it was not good to test it, no, because P1 is actually U1. So you didn't gain anything from testing it. And now the algorithm, the cost of the algorithm is 1 plus pj divided by P1 divided by U1. Where u, and since p1 is u1, this is just 1 plus 1 over u1. So in the worst case, these two ratios are the same, and this happens when u1 is just, this happens when it's the golden ratio. So this was a very simple example. And this already gives you an algorithm that is phi competitive, just test jobs when there are bigger than phi, when uj is bigger than phi, just test them. Otherwise, don't test them. And then it's very simple to show that you can reach. Now, this shows it for a single job or for a problem, for another objective where the objective is the make span. But for the sum of completion time, it gets a bit more complicated. So here are the results that we have. So this lower bound that I just showed you, we can make it stronger. So in fact, there's a lower bound of 1.8546 of the competitive ratio on any deterministic algorithm. And we are quite far. There's a simple algorithm that has ratio 2. So there's a big gap between those two. And the way we showed this lower bound, we actually came up with an instance that is very structured. So all the jobs in this instance, all the jobs have the same upper bound, So they are completely indistinguishable to the algorithm. That seems like it's the worst case. They cannot take any advantage of this from this upper bound uj. And the processing time is like these two extremes, either it's zero or it's p. And so for that specific lower bound instance, for this class of instances, we could come up with better algorithms that beat this ratio 2. But we are still not closing the gap. And for uniform instances where this pj can be anything, then we don't get so good, but we can still get better than 2. And clearly, randomization helps here, right? Because we are competing against an adversary that wants to produce an instance which the competitive ratio is big. So if you process jobs in a random order, you can actually do better than 2. In fact, you can beat the lower bound. So really, we can show that randomization helps in that problem, and there's a corresponding lower bound, but there is still some gap. So let's just look at two examples here. Two examples. So now I want to explain you how we can get this ratio 2. It's actually very easy. First, you execute untested all the jobs j for which uj is smaller than 2. Just execute them. So this will be the first part here that indicated by 1. And then for all other jobs for which uj is bigger than 2 or bigger equal, then you just test them. Just test all of them. This would be the part 2. And then you know their processing time and you execute them in optimal order. Okay, and then if you do a very simple analysis, you show that this is at most twice, as a cost at most twice the optimum cost. All right. So this was very easy. And for the lower bound, what are the techniques that we use in the lower bound? Usually for a lower bound, we see a problem of this form as a game played between an adversary and an algorithm. The algorithm wants to have the ratio as low as possible, and the adversary wants to make the ratio as large as possible. So consider a situation where all the jobs have the uniform upper bound, uj is just p, the same p for everyone. And consider now an algorithm. An algorithm has to decide how many jobs he wants to execute untested among those n jobs. And you know, clearly untested jobs, the adversary will make them short for sure. So pj will be 0 for those jobs. And among the tested jobs, that the adversary can decide how many will be short and how many will be long. So for example, here, he executed some jobs untested. This is the part 1. Then all the remaining jobs are tested. And the adversary decides, okay, let's say one job will be long. And in the worst case, this will be just the first jobs will be long. This is worse. And only at the end, some jobs will become short. And then also another thing is that the algorithm also has to decide among those long tested jobs if he wants to execute them right away or later on. And so he has to decide on this fraction. And if you look at this situation here, then in fact it's a game that is just played with different numerical parameters. The algorithm decides on some fractions according to this classification I just gave you, and the adversary also decides on some fractions. And then we can express the competitive ratio as a function of these fractions and look at the maximizer, minimizer of this, the competitive ratio with second order analysis. It's a bit boring, very tedious, but you can come up with this lower bound. And that's in the sense that how we show the lower bound. Okay, and then there are more results there, but there are 2 techniques. Okay, and now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the last model. It's the model number 3. So if you were lost until now, I mean, these models are a bit independent. So you can catch up. So this Fanny Dufossé, Noël Nadal, Denis Trystram, and Óscar Vásquez, we studied this problem that I present you now in a paper called Scheduling with a Processing Time Oracle. And it's a very simple setting. I mean, we want to make it as simple as possible, first to understand the simple case. Yeah, in fact, I really learned, I mean, when I finished my PhD, I didn't know how to do research. It's really Marek Hoback that, during my postdoc time, learned me how to do research. And his technique is to start with simple examples. Once we understood them, then we move to the next level and so on. So let's do this. And jobs, each job has a processing time that is either short, a length P, or long, P plus X. And P and X are some parameters that are known to the algorithm, and also N, and these are the only three parameters that are known to the algorithm at the beginning. The algorithm doesn't know which of the job is short and which is long. But you can do a test for a specific job, and it will reveal whether it's long or short. Again, it occupies time one on the schedule. Oh, I never told you, but this one is just the result of normalizing to make things easy. So how could you, in practice, how could you test a job? Well, suppose that you have a high-speed server very far from your office, and you could run the job there. It will take almost no time. And then you know whether it's quick or short, whether it's quick or long to execute the job, but you still need to schedule it locally because it needs some resources locally. So this was our motivation. Okay. So again, we want to minimize the competitive ratio of that problem. So we divide the, for a fixed schedule, we divide the objective, the sum of completion times, by the optimum. And the optimum actually knows which jobs are short and long and execute them in the right order. We want one example. We want all examples. Okay, I give you an example. Calm down, everyone. Okay. No, I wanted to do some jokes, but somehow they don't come out exactly like I wanted. I need to train more. So let's look at the following here. So we have four jobs that are called A, B, C, and D. And only the job B is long, but the algorithm doesn't know this initially, okay? Let's say P is 0.3 and X is 4.7, something like this. So the optimum would be to execute the short jobs first, A, C, D, and then B. And this will give a completion time that I write here. The sum of the completion times is 7.7. It's not very important, but I also wrote a sort of rank here. You could multiply the processing times by their rank and make the sum, it will give the same objective. Okay. So as an algorithm, since you cannot distinguish these jobs A, B, C, suppose you just touch them in that order, first A, then B, then C. And suppose as an algorithm, you decide, okay, I want to test the first two jobs. So you would test the job A first, and it turns out to be short, then you execute it right away. Then you test the job B, it turns out to be long, you decide to postpone its execution to the end. This is always optimal. And these arrows here indicate where the corresponding job is executed. And then maybe you decide to execute the job C and D untested. And if you sum up the completion times, it gives you something like 14.7 in this example. But there were other possibilities to an algorithm. You could execute all the jobs without testing, and this will give you a cost of 70.1, or you could test only the first job or the first three jobs, and then this you will have different costs. But you know the best cost was in this example to schedule the first two jobs. And remember, we want to minimize the ratio between this cost and the optimal cost. This is the competitive ratio. So how do we study this problem? In fact, first, there are some dominance rules. When you tested a job and it turned out to be short, then it's dominant to execute it right away. Clearly, because this was the whole point of testing. You want to know whether the short jobs, and you know that in the order, they should come first. And on the other side, if you tested a job and it turns out to be long, then you should execute it at the end of the schedule, postpone it at the end. Same thing. I mean, long jobs should come in at the end. So this means actually that with this dominance rule, the algorithm only needs to decide for every job whether you want to test it and then you execute it according to the dominance rule, or you execute it untested. So just a binary choice for every job. And we conjecture that an optimal algorithm will work in two phases only. So in the first phase, you test some jobs, and in the second phase, you execute all remaining jobs untested. I don't know if you remember, in the first model, this was also an optimal the structure of an optimal algorithm, but there it's easier to show because you just want to minimize some objective and you can come up with exchange arguments. While here, when you test or not test a job, this changes the possibilities for the adversary. And since you want to minimize the ratio and not the objective itself, it's actually hard to come up with an exchange argument. I still think that this is true, but that we didn't approach this conjecture with the right tools. I hope that someone can do it. We proved it for small instances, like when there are three jobs, we know it's true. And also we did a lot of numerical experiments that go in that direction. So I'm pretty confident, but it's just a conjecture. So this makes the result a bit weak. Yeah. Okay, so let's, as a warm-up, let's look at the situation for an adaptive algorithm. Non-adaptive algorithm. This means that the algorithm decides in beforehand how many jobs it wants to test and cannot decide then according to the outcome of the test. Okay, you just commit to how many jobs you want to test. And the adversary is actually easy. It just needs to decide among the untested jobs how many are short and among the tested jobs how many are short. So again, it's just, I mean, you can write the competitive ratio now on, I mean, algorithm decides on a fraction, adversary decides on two fractions. And again, you can write the competitive ratio as a function of these three fractions and just use second order analysis to come up with the optimal algorithm and also the worst instance, assuming this conjecture. Yeah, there's some question? No, there's no question. Okay. Yeah. All right. So this is actually, because we have such a simple setting, we could very quickly come up with the optimal algorithm. And this is raw. I mean, in online algorithms, usually it takes time. You have some lower bound, upper bound, it takes time to match them. But since the setting is so easy, we could actually come up with the optimal algorithm. And therefore, it doesn't really matter what the ratio of this algorithm is. The ratio was just there. The competitive ratio is just a tool to compare algorithms. But here we know that we have the best one. So yeah, the actual ratio is not very important. Okay, and for the adaptive algorithm, the situation is more complicated. And it's quite interesting, but it's also very technical. So this is the most technical part, and it's actually the last slide here, I mean, one of the last slides, and it works like this. So assume this conjecture that the optimum adaptive algorithm first tests some jobs and then moves to the second phase where he executes the jobs untested. So in a way, the algorithm is a sort of stopping rule. He decides when to stop testing, that's it. And the adversary, what can he do? for every tested job, he can decide whether it will be short or long. Okay. And so this is the interaction. This defines an interaction between algorithm and adversary that we can model as a path, as a walk on a grid like this. Suppose you have a grid here, n by n grid, but I look only at this upper diagonal part. And you have a sort of pebble that starts in the upper right corner here. And when the algorithm decides to test the job, the adversary, if decides to make the job, the job short, then this will result in a step down. And if the tested job is long, that this results in a step to the right. Okay, so if the algorithm will decide, will test all the jobs, then this will result in a path that will lead from the corner to this diagonal. And a path like this red path here. So an adversary is just a path. That's it. And an algorithm, what can you do? Now we need to associate to every cell along that path what we call a stop ratio. So this would be the ratio that is obtained if the algorithm decides at this point here, when the walk reaches this cell here, what will be the competitive ratio? Because when the algorithm decides to stop testing and execute all the remaining jobs, then there is no more interaction. And the adversary can very easily optimize how many jobs will be among the remaining jobs will be long, how many will be short. And the adversary can figure out what the adversary, what the algorithm can figure out what the adversary will do. So you can actually compute the stop ratio. And the stop ratio depends on three parameters. One is the number of tested short jobs, the number of tested long jobs. And another parameter that's not really shown here is the cost generated by the test so far. Okay. So if you fix an adversarial strategy, that is a path here that goes to this diagonal, along that path on every cell, there is a stop ratio and the algorithm will just stop wherever the ratio is lowest, right? Because he wants to have a lowest ratio. Okay, so this means now that the behavior of the algorithm is very simple. And now let's step to the side of the adversary. What is the goal of the adversary? He wants to get the ratio as high as possible. Suppose that the adversary already knows some strategies that force a ratio R star. And now he wants to decide whether it's possible to force a ratio that is bigger than R star, strictly bigger. So what we do is that in that grid, we mark some cells, and these are cells that the adversary should avoid. I mean, the path should not go through those black cells if he wants to have a ratio that will be larger than R star. So these are the cells that if the algorithm goes through that cells, the algorithm will stop immediately and get a ratio R star or lower. So the adversary wants to avoid these black cells. So this is a sort of forbidden cells for him now. And in gray are cells that lie somehow in the shadow. So no path should go through a gray cells because otherwise you're forced to go through a black cell as well. Okay. So now on this diagonal here, we want to have a path that has the minimum stop ratio along the path. And such a path is in fact, the envelope of this tableau that is formed by these gray and black cells. And so you have this envelope, you just follow the envelope and you look at the minimum stop ratio. And if this turns out to be less than R star, this was not good. Then you mark it as black as well. And if it's greater than, okay, the adversary find a better ratio and you can improve R star. And again, mark that cell. And eventually, if you continue like this, the adversary will fill out the whole grid here and figure out what is the best ratio for him. And the algorithm can actually simulate, I mean, compute, make this computation instead of the adversary. and figure out what is the worst case adversary for him. Then he knows what is the strategy that the best adversary will follow, and he can decide, okay, I can reach a ratio R star, and he will stop as soon as the stop ratio is below R star. So this gives an algorithm that runs in time n cube. So the grid has size n square. Finding such a path here takes time n, so in total it's n cube, to compute the optimal strategies for both the algorithm and the adversary. So again, we have a polynomial time algorithm to come up with the optimum algorithm for that problem. Okay, so this is what we have basically, and we also have some experiments, but I don't show them because I wanted to just tell you about the model and about the techniques that I used here. And now, yeah, in summary, I gave you three models, all with uncertainty that can be explored. So there's a notion of a test, and you can gain more information. And this is very interesting, I think, because we know that getting the right data is costly. And so this, I think, creates a need for models where you have to pay in order to get the right amount of information. In our case here, in fact, what is a test? Usually a test would be some inspection you do on a job that will reveal on statistics that you learned in the past some job characteristics, but they might be wrong, right? You don't know really in advance. So it might also be interesting to study a model where these tests are prone to errors. And then maybe you want to optimize in two directions, in a worst case direction where these errors actually happen, and another one where these errors don't happen. And you maybe you want to compute a sort of Pareto curve, like with these two measures here. Another thing is that if you want to go in a practical direction, actually my colleagues in Grenoble, Denis, Trystram, and and Fanny Dufossé, they're doing this right now. You want to implement a predictor on job length and use it in a scheduler to do a better schedule. So people look at this also at the moment. And I mean, in all these models that I presented you, these models make only sense if the tests are very long compared to job processing times. So if the tests are short, then you know you will test anyway all the jobs first, and then the model becomes a bit trivial. So yeah, so I hope that I got you curious in these models, and I thank you very much for your attention. I'm ready to take questions.
Okay, Christoph, thank you very much. And so I allowed participants to unmute themselves, so don't hesitate to unmute your microphone and ask questions directly. And if nobody is doing so for the moment, then Christoph, on page 6, if you can come back, you say that you require from the customer to know distribution on processing times to be able to use your model 1, right?
Yes.
But in fact, in model 1, you don't need to have full knowledge of distribution, don't you? Because you work just with the average or something like that, right?
Yeah, exactly. If all I need from this, so distribution is like a joint distribution. Yeah. And all I need from this distribution are these two values. Okay. You're perfectly right.
So, but it doesn't need to be any specific shape. It can be whatever shape of distribution which has this values.
Yeah, it could be a continuous distribution or a discrete one. That's what I understood from that paper. It works in those two models. And you're right. I mean, we only need these two expressions.
Okay. And did you consider also some other model where you would have like partial information about the distribution, maybe a little bit more than just these two, but something in between, what is maybe measurable or, I don't know, guessable? what might be useful for you?
I think in practice it might be useful to have a very rough grained distribution. You know,
I see. Mm-hmm.
You classify jobs between short, medium, long, and you know some the probabilities in each class, but you don't know more precisely inside each class. I think this is something that would make sense in practice.
Okay, some visualization, right? Okay.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, so I encourage the others to have the question or maybe share the views that you have on the problem.
Okay, wait, there was a question in the...
Okay, go ahead, please.
So Willem, he asked...
No, Willem is like... just sending the reference to... there is a question. Go ahead.
Yeah.
If you could repeat the question, because the others may be...
No. I think the question is very clear. I will repeat it. Yes, you're perfectly right. You understood exactly. So at any moment... In this picture, I draw three crosses that have high Smith ratio, but for an optimal algorithm, there will be at most one. And if there is one, that it should be executed right away. So the question was, I said that it's dominant that to execute high ratio jobs right away. And under this dominance, in fact, there will be at most one high ratio job among the tested jobs, and the best thing to do is execute it right away. So in fact, in reality, we will not have any job here, and then we have to decide something. Do you want to test one of these jobs, or do you want to execute the highest ratio job that is among the medium jobs? That's the only thing you need to decide. And I think what we know is that if there is no medium job, then it's dominant to test jobs. So it's better to test a job than to execute a low ratio job. Yeah. But don't be shy, huh? You can ask these questions with your microphone.
Claire, you wanted to ask something. I have seen that you unmuted yourself.
Yeah. It was just about this.
I don't hear you.
Idea of the. Do you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you now. Yeah.
So it was about the discrete processing time, because Christoph, when you consider either small jobs or large jobs in the model, or you just explained that it would be interesting to have some coarse grain approach.
Yeah, in general, I don't know exactly for which of the three models.
But are there models where you have a discrete number of processing times among which you?
Yeah, I mean,
you have a known distribution.
No, I mean that's the only. So this is model number one.
Uh-huh.
This is the only paper that I know, but it's quite recent also, that studies a problem with a stochastic model where you can make queries.
Yes, but even in your third model, you have something small and large.
Yeah, so the next two models, they're adversarial. There's no distribution.
Okay.
So here the algorithm competes with an adversary that wants to generate the worst case. So these two models were motivated by a situation when the customer, the one with the tie, doesn't even know the distribution. Even this he cannot give to us. Then we want to move to adversarial models.
Yes, some other question by Marcin.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we do.
Hi, Christoph, it's a very nice talk. So I have a question to model two. Have you considered the weighted variant, or doesn't make a difference at all if you have weights?
No, that would be a follow-up work.
Ah, I see.
So if I have a student that I don't like, I think I will give this problem to him.
Okay.
It was a lot of work, and I think with weights of.
Okay, I was hoping that you can present some easy reduction that the weight is actually the same or something like this.
Yeah.
Okay, get it. Okay, thanks a lot.
What if the student will discover the reduction? That would be painful. Okay, maybe Christoph, if I can discuss the case with, let's say, discrete values of processing times. Could be scheduling messages in communication protocols, because, for example, you have the packet of given length, so that you can have like uniform length packets, and then if the packet is lost, you need to resend the packet, right? So it might be the case that if the packet is resent, then the processing time is twice bigger, and if it doesn't need to be resent, it's just unit processing time, right? And you might also have some probability distribution function for those, because it's like statistic variable of certain, let's say, communication network in certain environment. That might be like a case for you.
Yeah, that's interesting, because packets get lost. That's what we heard when Claire was asking a question. Yeah. We know packets get lost sometimes. And
packet get lost, so you need to repeat the packet, and the packets have uniform length. So
but
if
you know what, I don't know well the network community, and people work on that often in some software. You can check whether it should compress data when sending, like in some chats. Sometimes you can check some boxes, and probably people looked at the motivation that I wrote in yellow here. Maybe people in the network community, they know how to deal with that.
Okay.
In fact, it's not the motivation that motivated the problem. No, we came up with the problem, then we tried to find a motivation that fits to it. I'm quite honest. Maybe people...
Okay, is there any other question?
Yes, there was a question by 18 SIP.
Okay.
Ah, yes, so exactly. So in this model, all the jobs are available from the beginning in all these three models. And of course, it would make sense to study an online problem where jobs arrive over time and have release time, and they are only available at the release time. So this could be some direction in a research agenda for the future. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, I think we have like one more question that could be asked. So, if no, so Christoph, let me thank you very much for that. We should say what will be the next talk. The next talk will be given by Ruben Ruiz, and he will speak about state-of-the-art flowchart scheduling heuristics in 2 weeks. It will be very Christmas-like talk because it will be the December. It will be the December 22nd. So I'm very much expecting what Ruben will show us on his Christmas talk. Thank you very much for being with us, and hope to meet you in 2 weeks. Okay. Bye bye.